Well, good morning, everybody. I trust that my camera is oriented the right way. Melissa's just gonna check to make sure. If it's not,
it's all good.
It's all good? Perfect.
Finally.
Well, everyone, welcome to church today. I know I'm not necessarily loving not being able to see you guys in person, but I am loving the commute. So, hope you're finding the silver linings where you can. And I'm just gonna give it a minute.
Yep.
Yeah, you gotta turn that off.
Okay.
I'll just give everyone a minute to log on, and then we'll get going with some worship. I'll open with a word of prayer. Thank you, God, for this day. Thank you for my church family. God, we thank you for this technology that allows us to continue virtually meeting together, even though we can't. And God, we know you are in control. And God, we pray for a quick end to this situation for many reasons, but one of them being so that we can meet together again to corporately lift up your name and worship you. But God, we know that you are everywhere and you hear us all. You hear our voices from all parts of this valley as one big choir singing to you. And so God, we lift up your name this morning. Praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. First song is He is Faithful.
Thank you. Oh,
and worship you, God. The next song we're going to sing is called Living Hope. And that's what we put our trust in today, in this season, in this time. Our living hope, that is Jesus.
Thank you.
God is that hope that we put our faith and our trust in, both yesterday, today, and forever. And God, we praise you that you are a hope worth leaning on. You are a solid rock, and we stand firm on you in any season, in any time. We praise your name. Amen. Well, thank you, family. We will pause our live stream and just stay tuned for Pastor Ann's live stream shortly. Thanks. Bye.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, Joel, Melissa, and I think it's Bethany. Forgive me if I have the wrong name, but thank you so much for beautiful worship this morning. My goodness, he is our living hope, and I just was so blessed by worship this morning. Anton and I were listening, enjoying the beautiful sunshine and enjoying the presence of God as you led us. What a fabulous church family. Everybody's joining in and everybody's doing their part, and together we're serving the Lord, and we are just, I believe we're growing in the Lord. I believe we're getting stronger together. So before I speak this morning, I want to give you a few announcements. The most exciting announcement for me is this week we're starting to pre-record our services. And it means it will be a lot easier for you folks to join in. You'll press one button and you'll have the whole service without having to switch between live streams. So we're very, very excited about that. I'm also excited that Pastor Trevor is going to speak next week. I'm looking forward to hearing Trev. He's always got a good word and something that I always take away. So be sure that you join us 10 o'clock next Sunday morning for our pre-recorded live stream. Now, what's going to happen is you're making comments, we're able to respond to you. So be nice, but I'm gonna enjoy responding to you and just seeing what the Lord is gonna do in our hearts together. I stole an idea, I have to admit, I stole an idea from somebody I love very much in Ontario this week. And Thursday morning at 10 o'clock in the morning, for 15 minutes, we're going to do some wonders in the Word. I'm going to invite you to join myself or Pastor Trevor and some others that I'm thinking of, but I won't name them. I'm going to ask them before I name them. And grab a coffee, 10 o'clock Thursday mornings. Come on to the Facebook page, CPC Life Facebook page, and we're going to just spend 15 minutes in the Word and see what the Lord will encourage you with. That's starting this Thursday morning, 10 o'clock. I also want to remind you that the food bank at the church is available. If you are falling short or can't get out for groceries and you need something from the food bank, or if you know somebody in the community that needs something from the food bank, I'd encourage you to call the church office. We want to help our community. We're excited to help our community. And talking about helping our community, Youth for Christ normally has their big fundraising banquet, and it would be held this Thursday. So they can't do it because we can't get together, but Youth for Christ is one of our home missions, and I am a big believer in Youth for Christ. As you know, I'm part of the board in Youth for Christ Victoria, and I chair our advisory committee here in Nanaimo. So I'm asking you to call or contact Youth for Christ and order a ticket online. They're going to do a virtual banquet. Let's get behind Youth for Christ. It is a home mission of ours, and enjoy their virtual banquet on Thursday. The other thing that I really love are our Tuesday tea and chats. You never know what's going to happen or where it's going, but join us. You can Zoom in. We do it via Zoom on Tuesdays at 2 o'clock. It's tea and chat or coffee and chat, whatever you want to call it, but do join us on Tuesdays at 2 o'clock. Youth, you guys are awesome. You guys and Pastor Trevor, like, you just have it happening right now. There's youth every Wednesday night via Zoom. I believe there's a home group on Sunday night. I know there is the family challenge every week. Listen, families, you have until tomorrow to have your formal dinner and send a picture to Pastor Trevor. I think Anton and I need to have a formal dinner tonight. I might even have him in a tie and suit jacket. We might be eating spaghetti, I don't know. But we'll have a formal dinner, man. I want to get in on the action. So if you haven't had your family formal dinner, do that and get a picture into Pastor Trev. Let's really enjoy these weekly family challenges. And I know your name will get dropped into the hat. You could win, I think it's pizza. You get a free dinner every week if you win that. And the other thing that I want to mention is your faithfulness in giving. Church, thank you, thank you, thank you. Please, I just can't say it enough. You have been faithful in continuing to give. Although the building is closed, we still have expenses to keep it going. We still have, we still have expenses, and you are so faithful. Thank you. Last but not least, this is Mission Sunday. Now, in my e-bulletin, or in the e-bulletin, I had two videos attached. One was from some dear friends in Southeast Asia. I believe I'm not supposed to say it publicly, but go and see that and enjoy a real update from this dear family. The other was the pregnancy, the Comox Valley Pregnancy Care Center. I believe that's what it's called. And we love our missions. We love our overseas missions. We love our home missions. We want to be sure to be praying for them and supporting them. There are many more that we support, but these are the two that we put in the e-bulletin. If you're not a regular subscriber to the e-bulletin, please let Sandy know at the office, and she'll be sure to get you on the e-bulletin. It's another way that we connect every week. I just write a little note to say, hey, you're awesome, and this is what God is doing. And this is Mission Sunday. You can give to missions online. You can say whether you want it to go to home missions, to overseas missions. But remember our missionaries. They're in countries around the world. Many of them chose to stay at the post and be in their countries and bless the people that they're with while we're going through this coronavirus pandemic. And then our home missions also need our support and our prayer. And I want to say thank you to our missions committee, who are so incredibly faithful in keeping us updated on what has happened. Jennifer McQuaid and committee, you're a blessing. God bless you all, and thank you so much. Well, I'm trying to project my voice a little more. I heard this week that sometimes people aren't able to hear me. We don't know if it's our camera or what it is, but I'm going to ask you to let us know. If it sounds like I'm shouting and I'm angry or something, please say, hey, PA, tone it down. But if it's coming across and you can hear me, just let us know. We're going to go into the Word this morning. We're starting a new series, and I'm very excited. Let's just pray for a minute. Father, we thank you that today is a day that you have made. We are your people, and we are rejoicing in this day. Today, Lord Jesus, we have homes and food and warmth, and we're healthy, and we're blessed to be a blessing, and we're able to give and bless our missionaries. We're able to give through a food bank at the church. Lord, there's just so many things that we are able to thank you for. And as we start a new series this morning, a little bit tongue-in-cheek with the title, I want to thank you for our families. I want to thank you that family is your idea, that you instituted the family. Lord, before the church, as we understand it today, there is the family, and it is blessed by God. And so as we start our new series this morning, we ask your blessing. Lord, may your word refresh and bless those who hear it this morning. And Lord, as we go again into another week in self-isolation, will you just give us the joy of the Lord, your presence, your peace, and all that we need as we continue to praise you and thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name, we ask these things with confidence. Amen. Well, this morning we are starting a fun series called Family Feud. Family Feud. And in brackets, here are these words: surviving self-isolation together in coronavirus 2020. Now, many of us, well, all of us belong to a family, but you know what we have known up until now is you get up in the morning, you have breakfast, mom, dad, whoever goes to work. Some may stay home, some go to work, kids go off to school, and that's normal life. And all of a sudden, we're all in the same dwelling together. You're in your home, Anton and I are in our home, and there's not a lot of places we're allowed to go. There's not a lot of getting out. I hope you're getting out and enjoying nature, because that's a real gift. But suddenly, we are together, 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 together. And in self-isolation, Pastor Trevor and I began to think about, well, how are families surviving in self-isolation? So we're going to call this series Family Feud, Surviving Self-Isolation in the Coronavirus 2020. I don't know if many of you know the show, although I suspect you do, if your TV is on at any time, called Family Feud. There is a show called Canadian Family Feud, and it's hosted by Jerry D. He used to be the teacher on the show. I think it was called Mr. D. And anyway, this is kind of a reality show in that you have two separate families. And I think there's four or five people in each family. They come together. If I was Jerry D, now that's going to take some imagination. One family would be represented by a person on this side. One family would be represented by a person on this side. Jerry D asks the question, and they're both poised with the buzzer. Whoever hits the buzzer first gives the answer. And it's called Family Feud. And of course, there are prizes, and I suspect money. I don't watch the show, but I know the concept of it. Well, anyway, there's a great commercial for Family Feud that was on recently that I just loved. There was a gentleman on this side, there was a lady on this side, and it was very obvious that whoever hit the buzzer first and whoever got the right answer went home with the whole package of prizes, whatever that was going to be. Here's the question. What does Popeye eat? Now, unless you were born yesterday, most people know that Popeye eats... Yeah, I can hear you saying it.
Spinach.
Spinach. Popeye eats spinach. Not the healthiest kind. As I recall, it was always tinned spinach, but Popeye the Sailor Man eats spinach. So the two people are at the desk. They're ready at the buzzer. And Jerry D says, "What does Popeye eat?" Boom! The lady gets it first. And she blurts out, "Chicken!" There is this moment of stunned silence. People can't believe this. It is possible that Popeye also ate chicken, but that is not the answer most people would give. Popeye eats spinach. And so the place collapsed after a moment of stunned silence in shock and in laughter. And I have a feeling at the end of that show, that woman's family probably was in the middle of a feud. How could you say chicken? Everybody knows Popeye eats spinach. Family Feud. Well, it was hilarious. I've seen the commercial a few times and I laugh every time I see it. But that's really the idea of what we're talking about in this series. How to be a family together with all the quirks, with all the quacks, with all the good stuff, with all the not so good stuff. How to be isolated together and not kill each other. You can repeat that. You can quote me on that. That's what this is about. Now, I realize all families are not the same. You have some families that are well-adjusted and you're breezing through this. Oh, you wish you could be freer, but hey, we're having a good time. This is a gift from God. We're enjoying it. You have some families that might be just surviving together. There are some families who are traditional. There's some families that are blended. There are some families that are single parent families. There are all kinds of different families. But whatever your home looks like, you are family. I want to say this to single parents. You have my utmost respect and admiration. However you became a single parent is, I don't know, but you're doing an incredible job and you're trying your best. I want to say that to blended families. You've taken two separate families maybe and put them together to try to make a new whole. You have my admiration and respect. There is a love for each other and a love for the children, just like the single parents have. I want to say to traditional families, you have my respect and my support, because no matter what kind of family you are, you're trying to do family together, and it is so important. I could go on. For those of you who have adopted children, for those of you who are fostering children, there are those of you who may have lost children. There are those of you who may have children who are in lifestyles that you don't necessarily approve of or understand. Whatever your situation, you are family. And you need to know that God is on your side and that God is working in your family to bring Himself glory and to bring you and your family together in Him. I want you to know that if you are single today, you are still part of your family of origin, and you have my respect and my admiration, because in your circumstance of being single, whether it's by choice or just by the age and stage that you are at, you are remaining faithful to the Lord, and you are deeply loved and deeply valued. And I want you to know that you are part of CPC family, and we all love you. And so I'm speaking to you as well today as part of family. You're doing family as best you can, and the circumstances are changing on a daily basis, and yet we are learning still to do family. There's an old saying out there, it says, you can't pick your family. You know, you can pick your friends, but you can't pick your family. Well, it doesn't always ring true in today's world. You can't pick your family of origin, but there are a lot of people who have picked their family. But this is true. None of us picked coronavirus, and none of us picked self-isolation. But this is the situation we're in. So there you are. You're watching church this morning on your TV or your computer with your family, I hope. You're wondering when we'll be able to get back together again. Life has changed. Today, instead of speaking to you in person, which I have to be honest, I miss. I really love being person to person and speaking to you that way because we get to interact a little bit more. But instead of speaking to you in person, I'm speaking to my handsome husband, which is wonderful. And then I'm also looking beyond him to my kitchen sink and island and the beautiful greenery that's outside our window. Life has changed, but what hasn't changed is God is still in control and we are all still family. So this morning, to start this topic of the family feud, surviving life in isolation, I'm going to talk on valuing your family. We're not going to go into the scriptures particularly that say, you know, husbands love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave his life up for it. Wives, respect and love your husbands. Children, obey your parents. We're not going to go into those scriptures because every family is so different. And when we're talking about family, I want all of you to feel included. I don't want to isolate just towards the traditional family or just towards the single family. I want all of you to be included. So we're going to look up some scriptures this morning on values, on valuing each other, and make them applicable to how we value each other as a family in this time of isolation. I looked up the word value. I was thinking about family values, and I went and looked up the word value, and maybe it wasn't the right search, because what came up every time I went into a dictionary, for instance, online, a value, it had a monetary notation attached to it, the value of goods, the value of the dollar, the value of this or that, and I thought, surely there's something somewhere that talks about the value of family and the value of relationships. So then I looked up the word values in the plural, and here's what came up, and I love it. And it's from the Cambridge Dictionary. It says, the beliefs people have, especially about what is right and wrong and what is most important in life, that control their behavior. What are your values? Do you value Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Well, I believe you do, because you're fellowshipping together. I watched your comments as the Sedan family were leading worship. They were beautiful. You were engaging with it. Do you value the beautiful country that we live in, the beautiful island that we live on? Can I tell you something? If you were born and raised on Vancouver Island, I know you appreciate it, but from somebody who's come from back east to BC and then from the mainland to the island, listen, this place is paradise. Like, if you have to be self-isolated, I cannot think of a better place to self-isolate than Vancouver Island. But keep it a secret. We want to keep it just the way it is. But what are your values? What do you value? What's important to you in life? What do you believe is good? What do you believe is bad? What are those gray areas in your life where if you were to get into a debate with somebody, you wouldn't really know what to say? These are things that we need to understand. And I actually think that this time of self-isolation is in part, it is a gift from God to be able to reflect and sit down and spend time in the Lord and spend some quiet time and think, Lord, where is my life at? Where are we at as a family? What do we value and how are we moving forward? Jesus spoke of the values that his father had, and he spoke most of his father's values in John chapter 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. You see, God valued humanity. God valued the restoration of our relationship with Him. Adam and Eve in the garden sinned. Sin separates us from God. And even before they sinned, God knew. Do you know nothing is a surprise to God? Coronavirus, self-isolation is not a surprise to God. But when Adam and Eve sinned, we were separated from Him, and it broke His heart. And so all along, His plan was to bring us back into relationship with Himself, to have family together, to have relationship together, not just during this short breath of a lifetime, but for all of eternity. And that is the greatest value of God, that you are restored to Him, that I am restored to Him, that we are restored to each other in relationship in Christ Jesus. I'm projecting my voice and my throat's getting dry, excuse me. That we are restored to Him in relationship. That is the biggest value of God. Genesis chapter 1, let's make man in our own image. And so you see, the greatest value of God is this love, healing, restoring, relational love. And then He institutes the family for healing, restoring, relational love. It raises an interesting question, doesn't it? How do you value your family? Now, I understand there are different experiences in family. Not everyone has been happy. I'm not playing La La Land here. But we're sitting here today as believers in Christ Jesus, and we need to ask ourselves the question, how do we value our family? How do we value our family of origin? How do we value the family that we're in? How do we value our church family? How do we value the body of Christ? Because family is a reality instituted by God. I love it. But that's the truth. What are your feelings when it comes to your family? I've seen various attitudes to family. I've counseled many, many people over the years. And here's some of the attitudes that I've heard over the years. I didn't ask for my family. They let me down, so I don't care. I love my family. And I'm talking smothering, needing love. And I can't survive unless they're constantly happy. And I'm happy making them happy. I continue to be hurt by my family, but it's my job to fix them and help them, so I stay engaged. I have a great family. When we're together, we have fun. When we're apart, we still know we love each other. It's a great family. Do you love your family with all its nuances and its quirks? I'm going to say this and include myself. We all have quirky families because we're all part of a family. You have quirks. I have quirks. Anton has a ton. No, I'm only kidding. We have quirks. We're all part of a family, and we all have our little differences. Do you love your family from a distance for your own safety and protection? Or do you love them from a distance because you really can't stand them? To give them freedom to be who they are? Or do you find yourself striving to change them? They're good questions. But in the world that we're living in, these become more prevalent and more important than other. You are with the family that you have. You were born into a family. That's your reality. That's your family. And if you have children today and a spouse or a single parent or blended, you've created the family that you are currently living in. That's your reality. How do you feel about your family? And how are you working with your family, especially in self-isolation? Well, we're going to look at some things about the family in Scripture. First of all, I'm going to say we need to accept our family. I didn't say we need to accept abuse or unhealthy patterns of hurt. I just said we need to accept them for who they are. They're our family. Sometimes people say, I can't accept my dad. I can't accept my brother or my sister. You can't accept maybe the hurt and the abuse that was caused by them. But you must accept the fact that they are my family. This is my father. This is my mother. We must take ownership of the family that we are in. In other words, we can't be dreaming about being, you know, wished I was born into a different family. No, you were born into your family, and God knows your name. I have a young lady in my life that I love dearly. She's going to be 13 on her next birthday. It's very, very important to her that everybody knows she's 13. And so I sent her a little text this week and said, "Hey, I miss you. How are you doing?" Here was her reply. "I'm so bored and my brother is driving me nuts. So I'm about to die, I think." Now, if you knew this young lady, you would understand her humor. She is hilarious. She sent me a couple of more texts and said, "My funeral will be such and such a date." And I said, "Oh my gosh, thanks for letting me know, because I would like to be included and say a few loving thoughts about you." But this kid is hilarious. But what she said is true. "I'm so bored and my brother is driving me nuts. I think I'm about to die." Acceptance of her family right now would be to be able to get away from her brother, have a little bit of space, breathe, and then carry on. Well, you know what? We can all get to that point in self-isolation if we're not careful. But let's look at some scripture now about what we can do. The Apostle Paul in Romans 14 and 15 was talking to the church. However, what he was saying to the church is applicable to us today and in our family life. So I want to give you a couple of scriptures from Romans 14 and 15, and then we're going to talk about them. Romans 14, 19, Paul says this, "Let us therefore make every effort to do what leads to peace and mutual edification." There's a word for you. Romans 15, 5 to 7, "May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had, so that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Here we go, you ready? "Accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God." These are incredible values for your family, for how you see your family, and for how you do life together, especially in isolation. Paul says, make every effort. Make every effort. As you're doing family life in isolation, whether you're mom, dad, son, daughter, brother, sister, grandma, grandpa, auntie, uncle, whatever your role is in family, make every effort for the good of the family. See, you're responsible for you. You're not responsible for the choices everybody else makes. But you are very responsible for you, and you are in family, and you are called to make every effort to make this thing work. You say, "Anne, if you knew my family," I don't, praise God. But you are still responsible for you. See, you are a separate identity within the family unit, and your choices affect everybody else in the family. Every family does a dance. Did you know that? It's not a physical dance, you know, where we're doing this. But every family does a dance. They sort of do a dance with and around each other. They all make their choices. Their choices affect each other. And they're constantly doing the family dance. What has changed for your family right now is you're doing the family dance in self-isolation. And the first thing that you have to realize is you're not the center of the world. I sound like I'm scolding you. I'm not, but I'm just trying to preach some real truth for self-isolation. None of us are the center of the universe. None of us are the center of our family. We are all part of a whole. And everything we do affects that whole. Joyce Meyer often says it. She's famous for this. "Don't let your emotions control you," she'll say. "Emotions lie." Well, Joyce, you're probably very, very right. Some days that's easier said than done for some people. But see, Jesus came because his Father asked him to sacrifice his life for humanity, which he said is my family. Jesus put in the effort for us to the point of death. None of us yet have died for our family. Others today are saying, "Well, we're very fortunate. We live in a beautiful country and we have a lot of things. We're not struggling like other nations." And that's true. And thank God for that. But none of us have put in effort for our family to the point of death. We are responsible to make every effort to care for and encourage our family. I think of the account of Esther in the Old Testament. Now, Esther wasn't in a typical family, but it's very similar to many that we have today and good principles. Let me read to you from Esther 2, verses 5 to 7. Now there was in the citadel of Susa a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin, named Mordecai, son of Gair, the son of Shimei, the son of Kish, who had been carried into exile from Jerusalem. Let's just start there. They had been captured and carried into exile from Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, among those taken captive with Jehoiakim, king of Judah. Now, just to give you a little bit of background, Jerusalem was totally destroyed and burnt to the ground. The temple was burned, I think it was in 56. But the Babylonians did that. Jehoiakim was the last king of Judah. He came on the throne and he reigned for 3 months before he was taken captive. With him, in particular, all the people of Jerusalem were taken captive, which included this fellow, Mordecai. Now, Mordecai had a cousin named Hadassah, whom he brought up because she had neither father nor mother. It's possible that her parents were killed in the siege. Jerusalem had been under siege. They had starved the people to death. It's possible that her parents had been killed in the siege. This young woman, who was also known as Esther, had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Mordecai had taken her as his own daughter when her father and mother died. They were living in exiles as slaves, Mordecai and Esther. Their lives weren't their own. They would live or die at the whim of their captors. If you looked at your captor the wrong way, off with your head, you could be gone. You didn't know from one second to the next if you were going to make it through that day. They were exiles. It sounds a little bit like today. They were looking for deliverance while having to put some effort into their lives in a very difficult time. We're looking for deliverance from coronavirus today, but we've got to put the effort into our family and the value into our family while we're going into a difficult time. Going back to Romans, Paul says, make every effort to do what leads to peace and mutual edification. That's the bottom line. Value your family and make every effort, always, but especially in self-isolation, to do what leads to peace and mutual edification. Husbands, how are you blessing your wives in this time? Wives, how are you blessing your husbands in this time? How are you blessing your children? Kids, how are you blessing mom and dad? What are you doing as a family in unusual circumstances to show each other that you value each other and that you're going to do this together and come out better for it? See, when I go back to Esther, they're exiles. They're living in incredibly difficult times. But Esther lived in obedience to her adopted father and did ultimately what led to peace and deliverance, not only of she and her adopted father, but her entire race. We know in the account of Esther that the king was looking for a new queen, and through obedience to Mordecai, Esther became the new queen. As soon as she was the new queen, almost, she faced a dire situation. The king, through influence of some people in his government, had set a date to wipe out every Jew that they had captured. Can you imagine? You're in a difficult situation. You're in quarantine. They called it exile, but you're in quarantine. And now you find out that your entire race is going to be eradicated because of some guy in the king's government. Mordecai calls on Esther and he says to her, listen, you have to intervene. You're the queen. You got to do something for your family, for your race, for your nation. You've got to go to King Xerxes and you got to plead for your nation. Esther's terrified. She goes, if I do that, I could die. Mordecai says, do it anyway. Do it anyway. What are some of the things, families, that you need to do anyway in order to survive self-isolation and show value to each other? After 5 weeks in self-isolation, you may get tired of having to cook or wash the dishes or clean the bathrooms. You may get tired of having to cut the, you know, whatever it is, but do it anyway. You see, one of the scriptures that I love in the New Testament was in 2 Kings 25. The people were taken into exile, and one of the prophets said, look, settle down in the land and serve the king of Babylon, and it'll go well with you. Settle down in self-isolation. We don't know how long it's going to be, but settle down, serve the government, do what God calls us to do, and it'll go well with you. Blessings will follow. See, you lead the way to peace and edification in your family. Mom, dad, stepdad, stepmom, adoptive parent, kids. Little ones don't understand. But if you're a teenager watching me today, God bless you. Let's start there. What can you do to help build your family? I love this. Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers in Matthew chapter 5, verse 9. I love what the Message version says. It says, you are blessed when you can show people how to cooperate instead of compete or fight. That's when you discover who you really are and your place in God's family. Your blessing is in your cooperating. Your life right now is more about working together and being aware. Your life is about blessing each other. It's in your cooperation. And when you're cooperating, you begin to discover who you really are, and you begin to discover your place in God's family. I'm a child in God's family, but as a child in God's family, He's placed me in family just like you, and He's given us the mandate to bless and to encourage and to love and to edify and to build up. What are we doing about this? The one thing that I noticed about Queen Esther was I never heard her complain about her family structure. Complaining is a tool of the enemy. Listen, if you have a complaining spirit, the enemy is having a heyday. Well, I don't like this, or I don't like that, or I'm sick and tired of this, I'm sick of that. Listen, that is a trick of the enemy. He wants you to complain. He wants you to grouse. He wants you to be miserable. Jesus said, I have come to give you joy. And I've come to give you peace. And I've come to give you courage. And I've come to give you strength. That's what God gives to us. If you're struggling with complaining during this, if you're struggling with self-pity during this, in Jesus' name, be free right now. And begin to take on attitudes in the Lord that will bring you peace and joy. We know that as Esther obeyed Mordecai, she had the people fast for 3 days. She went into the king, and the long story is the king said, all right, I'm not going to kill the Jews. I'm going to save them. Her attitude of obedience, her attitude of cooperation, her attitude of doing what her adoptive father, through God, was asking her to do, saved an entire nation. What am I saying this morning? Let me sum it up for you. I'm saying this morning that every one of you in your family, as you value your family, as you pour love into them, as you pour cooperation into them, as you pour edification and encouragement, as you put yourself out for your family. We begin to help and save your family through this and have you stronger as our government releases us to go into life in the future. Your family is your gift from God. See, we are carriers. Our government recently has said, or some of our doctors have said, treat everybody like they're a carrier of COVID-19. Well, for your own safety is not a bad idea. Social distance. But let me take that even deeper. Treat everybody like you're a carrier of the Spirit of Almighty God, because you are. Treat everybody with the heart of Jesus, who thought nothing of himself and came down and died for you and me. Treat everybody with a spirit of sacrificial love. Yeah, but my brother's driving me crazy. I'm going to have to text my little friend and say, sweetheart, love him anyway. He's the brother God gave you. I didn't say treat everybody with doormat love. You're not called to be a doormat. You're a child of God. You have great value. And you, person of great value, in your family of great value, can encourage and bless and edify and lift them up. What are your family values? Are they to tear down or are they to lift up? In this time in particular, if your family is having issues with what their values are, sit together today. I pray that you will sit together today and say, I'm sorry if I've been hurting you. Let me tell you how much I value you and let us change together. Family values in Christ Jesus are life-transforming things. So first and foremost, you accept your family as they are and for who they are. Secondly, you lead your family towards cooperation and encouraging relationships. And third but not least, you support and you love your family in whatever way God calls you to. For all of us, that means watching our thought life. For all of us, that means watching our attitudes. Let me give you some practicals. If you are in a crowded home with family, make sure everybody has some space every day because everybody needs a little bit of space. Make sure everybody's pitching in. Kids, if mom and dad have been working at home all day and then they've made dinner for you, help them, clean the kitchen, bless them, find ways to bless them. Write notes to them. Tell them that you love them. Husband and wife, see if you can't find some time just to say, I love you. It's a crazy world we're in right now, but I love you. If you're in blended families, if you're in single parent families, tell each other you love each other. Find ways to love and respect each other. Find ways to have a little space, find fun ways to come together. That's one of the reasons I love Pastor Trevor's challenges every week. As a family, you've got one way to come together every week just to have fun. Listen, families, make sure you have fun. Moms and dads, don't get overtaken with the bad news. Make sure that your head is being filled with the good news. Make sure that your mind is being filled with the good news of Jesus Christ. Get in the Word every day. Listen, if you're not used to being in the Word, now's a perfect time to do it. Get into the Word every day. God, speak to me today. Give me something today. Get into prayer every day. Lord, I thank you for this day. This is the day that you've made, and I'm going to rejoice, and I choose to be a blessing today. God wants you and your family to be a living light to those around you of his grace and his blessing. You don't need to be in a family feud. You can set the example for how to avoid a family feud and how to be a family and a unit of love and grace and the joy of the Lord that is your strength. I'm going to leave you first with a scripture from Colossians this morning, Colossians 3, 12 to 14. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves, here we go, with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Family values, compassion, humility, kindness, gentleness, patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Easy for me to preach, maybe, but it has to be where the rubber meets the road. And he goes on and says, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them together in perfect unity. Value your family. This week and every week, value your family. And ask God during this time of self-isolation to give you the ability to love, to have compassion, to have humility, to have kindness, to have patience, and to be quick to forgive, quick to forgive, and slow to be angry. Find ways to have fun and value each other. You're in your family for the rest of your life. Your physical family now, your family of origin. And you're in the family of God. And here's the thing. Family is God's idea. So do you value your family? Are you showing them how much you value them? Are you loving on them? Are you giving them space? Are you speaking encouraging words to them? Are you finding ways to have fun together? And are you doing family with the knowledge that God loves you and created you and has allowed you to be blessed with each other? Because after all, family is God's best idea. Let me pray with you. Every week after our sermons, Pastor Trevor and I are going to put on our Facebook some discussion questions for you right away so that you can talk as a family about how you're valuing and loving each other. Are you ready for those? I hope so. Take some time today. Now let's close our eyes and just pray together. Father, I thank you for every person who has been with us this morning in Comox Pentecostal Church. I thank you that we are part of your family, that we are part of our church family, but more wonderful, we're part of our physical families today. There may be parents watching with kids. There may be grandparents watching who are thinking of their kids and grandchildren. There may be single parent families, blended families. There may be adoptive parents thinking of their children. Lord, there may be single people watching today thinking of the family of origin. Whatever our situation, thank you that we are in the family of God, that we are together in Comox as CPC. Thank you that we have the choice to edify, to build up, to love, and to speak encouragement to each other. As we go into this week and as we look at being self-isolated again this week, we thank you that we have a beautiful island to be isolated on. We thank you that we have wonderful nature to get out into. We thank you, Lord, that we are healthy. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that we have Jesus as our Savior and you as our strength and our truth, and that we can live each day knowing that you are in control, Father God. We surrender ourselves to you. Lord, for families that are struggling, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that you will bring your calming spirit, that you will bring a spirit of forgiveness, that you will bring, Lord, we come against the destruction in families that the enemy would have brought. And we speak against it and destroy it this morning in Jesus' name. We speak a spirit of unity to families. We speak a strengthening to families as we move forward. And we thank you for the family. Jesus, we love you, we praise you, and we bless you this morning. In your wonderful, mighty name, we pray. Amen. Family of Comox Pentecostal Church, we love you. Have a wonderful week. And don't forget to check Facebook in the next couple of minutes. I'm going to throw some questions up for you real quick. God bless you. Amen.